Now we're ready to move on to the higher carbon homologues of the monosaccharides, starting with the tetroses. And let me just say, it would be very helpful, I think, if you would pause the recorder right here and go ahead and build a molecular model of the tetroses, starting with erythrose. So the reason that this is going to be important is because I really think that getting down the tetroses in your mind and seeing how you manipulate them is going to make everything else that follows quite straightforward. If you don't go to the trouble of building a model, either with a physical plastic model or on your computer screen, I really think it's going to be much more challenging for you when it comes time to look at the more complex cyclic forms of these monosaccharides. So getting this part down is going to facilitate everything that comes later. Building a molecular model is one of the most important things that you could do at this point. All right, so with your model in hand, basically we're going to start with deerythrose, and we're going to look at the Fischer projection. All the carbons, all four carbons, are in the vertical plane. It's a D sugar, meaning the bottommost hydroxyl group, the stereocenter at carbon 3. That hydroxyl group is on the right-hand side in the Fischer projection, so we know that this is a D sugar. What we need to do then is convert this Fischer projection into a structure that we're more used to looking at, and that would be the line angle drawing. So the planar zigzag form is the way we see it, but this is the form that makes us most convenient for comparing to the Fischer projection, because what we have in this view that's shown in the middle here is the view where each of the wedges are pointing upward. And so if you were a person who was looking from above at each of these, what you would see in your mind's eye is the structure that's shown up here. The top of your head is where the aldehyde group is. Down here where the neck is carbon atom number 3, and what you see is this vertically oriented position. Off to the right is the hydroxyl group on carbon atom number 2, and your left hand would be oriented toward that hydrogen atom on carbon number 2. So that's convenient for comparing the Fischer projection to the three-dimensional form. And the next atom, we could just move our head down slightly, and now you see with the neck still oriented down toward carbon atom 4, the top of the head up here toward carbon atom number 2, we're looking at carbon atom number 3, and it's again vertically oriented in the way that it needs to be in order to see the Fischer projection view. And again, we see, as this happens to be a D sugar, the hydroxyl group will always be on the right-hand side at that bottommost configuration. And so that's the way, and in this person's mind's eye, that's what they see. They're viewing the hydroxyl group with their right hand, the hydrogen with the left hand, C2 and C4 at the top and the bottom. Well, that's not such a convenient way to represent it, and so here's the Fischer projection view, and the normal way we would like to treat such a model is actually to put it in a planar zigzag form, and so we're going to do a bond rotation about the 2-3 atom. The aldehyde position is here, the C4 is over here. All I did was take that convenient view of the Fischer projection and now rotate about the 2-3 bond to put that into a planar zigzag form. And so the planar zigzag form reorients that last group. I left this position fixed and I rotated that bottom position, and so now notice the hydroxyl group is coming out towards us rather than going back. That's where a model will make the most sense. So D3-ose is an epimer at one position. An epimer is an epimer has a diastereomeric relationship, and it has a configuration one configuration that's changed. And so the epimer of erythrose is 3-ose, which means, and it's also D3-ose, so we don't change that bottommost position. We're going to change the configuration at C2. So erythrose and 3-ose are known as C2 epimers. And if we were to then put this into the planar zigzag form, just like I did before, now you can see that the hydroxyl group that's on C2 is where the variation comes in at. Those are the two forms of the C4 monosaccharides, the two epimers of the C4 monosaccharides. Now let's look at some pentoses and hexoses. We'll also compare aldoses and ketoses. Let's start with D-ribose. This is an important building block for the sugar part of nucleic acids. vertically oriented carbon chain. There's three stereocenters. They're all on the right-hand side. It's a D sugar. Our bottommost position has the hydroxyl group located on the right-hand side. There's the aldehyde. There's the CH2. Now you need to build a model and do two bond rotations to take this form that's convenient for looking at it and comparing it to the Fischer projection, where all three hydroxyl groups are on the same side, to a view in which we have to do two bond rotations to make this into the planar zigzag form. And when you do that, you can see that the position at C3 has its hydroxyl group coming out, whereas C2 and C4 have hydroxyl groups going back. Here's an example of a ketose. Notice it's a ketone functionality. At C2, that's where the carbonyl usually is in ketoses. There's a carbon-oxygen double bond there. C1 no longer has a stereocenter, so this hexose, which has six carbon atoms in it, has at positions 3, 4, and 5 stereocenters, and it's again D because the bottommost hydroxyl group is on the right-hand side. Here's a form that's convenient for showing the three stereocenters in a way that we can compare to the vertical chain of that Fischer projection, and our, you should imagine in your mind's eye moving around with a sight, a line of sight, as you saw in that previous slide. And so when we do the rotation, we end up with that D fructose form as shown there, with the three stereocenters, hydroxyl group at C3 pointing to the left, hydroxyl group at C4 pointing to the left, and then that bottommost hydroxyl group will be over to the right. The aldohexoses are some of the most important building blocks in biology, and D-glucose is a structure that you may want to commit to memory. I just say it's right, right, left, right, and so if you just think about that rhythm, right, right, left, right, starting from the bottom, working your way up. We start from the bottom because we know it's the D sugar, so right, right, left, right is the orientation of D glucose. And then an epimer at C2 is D mannose. That's an important sugar in biology. And so we've changed that hydroxyl group at C2 from being located on the right-hand side as it was in D glucose to being on the left-hand side. D-galactose, another important biological sugar, is an epimer at C4, and so we have the hydroxyl group on the left-hand side in D-galactose, whereas it was on the right-hand side in glucose.